All right, turn to 1 Thessalonians 5. While you're turning there, some of you may have heard this before, but there's an inscription that is interesting. It's on an old gravestone in an old English cemetery outside Windsor Castle. And it's been talked about over the years. It says, "Pause, my friend." This is on the gravestone. "Pause, my friend, as you walk by. As you are now, so once was I. As I am now, so you will be. So prepare, my friend, to follow me." Well, upon reading that inscription, there was somebody that had a great tagline that they added to it. It says, "To follow you is not my intent until I know which way you went." That is so true. As followers of Jesus Christ, we alone know where we're going. We alone know what's going to happen in the future. We know where we're going to spend eternity in the very presence of Jesus Christ. And the only reason we have such confidence and assurance of where we're going is because of the resurrection of Christ, because he is alive and he's given us these promises. We have his word on it. We are assured of these things, and his promise is to return for us. And if you believe that Jesus, you know, spoke the truth, then you have that beloved assurance as well. So make no mistake about it, Jesus is coming soon for his bride. This is what we talked about last week in chapter 4, the rapture of the church from verses 13 through 18. The Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, the trumpet of God. The dead in Christ, all those who have died the last 2,000 years in Christ, the dead will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the air to meet the Lord in the clouds, to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. And so he is coming back for his bride, and then Jesus is coming back to planet Earth about 7 years later. And when he comes back at his second coming, he's going to establish his kingdom on earth, which will reign for 1,000 years. He will rule and reign from Jerusalem. We'll be in our resurrection bodies. In fact, we will be coming back with him at his second coming. And it's going to be a glorious reign. It's going to be full of righteousness, peace, and joy. Again, between the rapture and the second coming, though, there's this time known as the wrath of God. It's the judgment of God upon planet Earth. Jesus calls it the Great Tribulation. It'll last 7 years, according to Daniel chapter 9. There's 70 weeks given to the Jews. The 70th week, which is a seven-year period, has not yet been fulfilled. And that's when God will start the clock back with the Jews in these last days. And so the Great Tribulation is what he is going to do, not only judging this world, but reestablishing the Jews and bringing them to faith in Christ at the second coming. Because we're told very clearly that when Jesus returns, Romans 11, 25 and 26, every Jew that is alive and make it through the Great Tribulation will get saved. They will receive Jesus, as Zechariah 12:10 says. They will mourn for him as a mother mourns for her only son. And they will ask him, "Where did you get those wounds in your hands?" "I got those in the house of my friends." And it's at that moment when they will realize Jesus Christ has been. He was our Messiah, and they will receive him and be forgiven. And then they will go into that glorious 1,000-year reign of Christ. But the 7 years of great tribulation, we'll talk a little bit about that tonight, because that is an unparalleled time in human history of destruction. Again, it's when God is pouring out his wrath upon this planet, upon those who have rejected Christ. The Apostle Paul calls it the day of the Lord, as we'll see in a moment. In the book of Revelation, it is called the day of wrath, God's day of wrath. It's called the wrath of the Lamb. Kind of a weird term, wrath of the Lamb. You know, always picture Lambo. You know, Jesus is Lambo. Anyway, you know, but it's called the wrath of the Lamb, the hour of trial. It's also called the hour of judgment. Many Old Testament prophets spoke of this day, and they said it was a time of trouble, a time of distress, time of devastation and desolation, darkness, gloominess, a day of clouds and thick darkness. This is why Jesus said of this time frame, "Unless those days were shortened, no flesh would be saved." And the only reason it's going to be shortened is, well, Jesus is going to come back, and it's through his second coming when he mounts up in his white horse and he comes bursting through the heavens and he brings an end to all the death and destruction, because it's at the tail end of the battle of Armageddon when he returns. And so this world's on the brink of annihilation. You know, we think things are bad now. During the Great Tribulation, it's going to be unbelievably horrible. In fact, let's look at the most glorious description we have of the second coming of Christ. You can see it's on the screen, right? Revelation 19. If you want to turn there, starting in verse 11, this speaks of the second coming of Christ. Now, I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on him was called Faithful and True. This is Jesus, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. So he's coming back to bring an end to the Great Tribulation. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. Where'd he get all those crowns? Well, remember, he gives us crowns. And then we cast those crowns at his feet, back in chapter 4 and 5 of Revelation. So he's coming back with many crowns on his head. He had a name written that no one knew except himself. He was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. So we know, obviously, this is Jesus. And notice the armies in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. Now it's back in verse 8 of this same chapter that we're told it's the bride of Christ who's dressed in fine linen, white and clean. So this is you and me. When we're coming back with the Lord, we'll be riding on white horses as well behind him. We're not doing anything, just following him. He does all the work. He does all the battling, and we just follow him. But it says in verse 15, now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should strike the nations. And he himself will rule with a rod of iron. He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he has a name on his robe and on his thigh, a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Then I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the birds that fly in the midst of heaven, come, gather together for the supper of the great God, that you may eat the flesh of kings, the flesh of captains, the flesh of mighty men, the flesh of horses and those who sit on them, and the flesh of all people, free and slave, both small and great. These are all those who have rebelled. These are all those who have taken the mark of the beast during the great tribulation. And he says, and I saw the beast, that's the Antichrist, the kings of the earth, gathered together to make war against him who sat on the horse and against his army. Now, at this moment, the Battle of Armageddon has taken place. Nation is fighting against nation in the Valley of Megiddo, there in northern Israel. And we've been there many times, standing at the rim there, looking over this valley. It's going to be an amazing scene when this happens. The Antichrist is fighting against these nations. But then when Jesus returns and they see this big cloud coming down, the Antichrist and everybody else is going to turn against the Lord and try to battle against Jesus. Stupid, you know. Verse 20, then the beast, that's the Antichrist, was captured, and with him the false prophet, that's his right-hand man, who worked signs in his presence by which he deceived those who received the mark of the beast and those who worshipped his name. These two were cast alive in the lake of fire burning with brimstone. So those are the very first two people that get cast into the lake of fire. It's later on in chapter 20 that after the millennial reign of Christ, this world and the universe is going to be vaporized by the Lord, and then he's going to have the great white throne judgment, and then all the people that have rejected the Lord will stand before the great white throne judgment, sentenced to the lake of fire. So these are the only two at this moment for 1,000 years. They'll be in there. It says in verse 21, and the rest were killed with the sword which proceeded from the mouth of him who sat on the horse, and all the birds were filled with their flesh. And I've always wondered if the birds are going to be saying, it tastes like chicken. That's what we always say, but anyway. So in between the rapture and the second coming of Christ, we have this period known as the Great Tribulation. It lasts for 7 years. So back here in 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 1. But concerning the times and the seasons, brethren, you have no need that I should write to you. Now, Jesus criticized the religious leaders in his day because they did not recognize the times and the seasons of his coming. I mean, he was fulfilling prophecy after prophecy. Again, over 300 prophecies at his first coming. Once, you know, over and over again, he's fulfilling all these Bible prophecies, proving that he was the Messiah of Israel. But because they had spiritual blinders on, they failed to recognize him. And so instead of receiving Jesus as their Lord and Savior, they end up crucifying him, nailing him to a cross. So Paul's point here is that we should recognize the spiritual climate for the times in which we live. And the simple fact is, every generation of Christians should know that we are children of light. The world, they're children of darkness, those who are not saved. This worldly system is dark, and it's getting darker all the time. And so the point is, what time is it? Well, for us who know the times and the seasons, it's time to live for Jesus. It's time to serve the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. It's time to know that Jesus is coming back for us real soon. The times and seasons all point to the nearness of his return. And again, look what's happened in the world in the last 18 months. No, but a few years ago, nobody was thinking this kind of stuff. You know, and this is what they're wanting to do, more lockdowns, you know, more mandates. You know, I've talked to a number of people this week that do work in for the state, different agencies, and they're saying, you must get the vaccine. Or some will say you can get tested twice a week and then wear a mask every day. Or if you don't get it, you're not going to have a job. And so it's just like, this is not even legal. You know, I encourage you to go on some of these websites. Candace Owens has a good website, and she talks about these things where this goes against the Constitution, and there's a lot of people in the military that are stepping up saying, we are not going to do this because this is illegal. It goes against every right that we have in the Constitution. And so people need to, you know, press back on these things because it's getting crazier and crazier all the time. 2 weeks, flatten the curve. Okay, we did. We shut down for a couple weeks. 18 months later, oh no, we're going to have to go back to a lockdown. It's just crazy, the things that we're seeing and how the world is taking this and running with it. The Great Reset. Google, what's his name, Schwab? Klaus Schwab. That guy's a maniac. You can edit this later, Bill, I hope. I mean, it's crazy the things that they're proposing. And they're wanting to say, we got to get the population down under 1 billion. Bill Gates Foundation is behind this. He's on their team with the Klaus Schwab Foundation, the Great Reset, the World Economic Forum is what it's called. You Google all these things, you're going to find some crazy things that they're trying to implement in the world, and they're taking advantage of this. This is a plandemic, folks. And we're seeing more and more evidence every day. As you say, got to believe science. Well, science says if you've been, you know, like me, I got COVID last November. I got over it. I got antibodies. You know, there's, well, you're a danger to society. No, I'm not. Look at Senator Lindsey Graham just a couple days ago. Came down with COVID, even though he had all the vaccines, both shots, a few months back. People that were in our church, you just got back from Africa. I'll try to be careful not naming names, but they just got back. They got their shots back in April. They got back. They got COVID. You know, it doesn't stop it. It's going to run its course. Every virus in the history of mankind has always had to run its course. If you have issues, if you are elderly, if you have problems, yeah, it might be a good thing. There's no condemnation at all, but common sense. If you are young and healthy, 99.9% of the people, they're young and healthy, no conditions, they get COVID, they're fine. And we've never done these extreme things to try to bring everybody under one system. And it's getting very, very socialistic, communistic. I mean, it's getting strange by the minute. So that was a tangent, sorry. Verse 2, He says, for you yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night. Once again, the day of the Lord refers to certain judgments that God will pour out on this world. Revelation 6 through 19 gives us a precise list of these horrific judgments. Now, why does the day of the Lord come as a thief in the night? Because it comes unexpectedly. You don't prepare for a thief in the night. It just, if you got robbed at night, you weren't expecting it. So Jesus says it's going to happen like a thief in the night. So here's the way I see it playing out. The rapture is going to happen at any moment. And when it does, hundreds of millions of believers are going to be instantly brought into the presence of the Lord. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. At the last trumpet. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 50 to 52 talk about this thing very clearly. This mortal must put on immortality. I guarantee there will be a lot of confusion, a lot of chaos in the world once the rapture takes place. But the very first judgment from God that we read about in the book of Revelation, Revelation chapter 6, verse 2, after Jesus takes the scroll from the Father's hand, and that's the title deed to planet Earth, and then he opens up one scroll after, or seal on the scroll after another, the very first seal he opens on the scroll, the Antichrist comes on the scene. He opens it up. John's looking, and he sees this rider on a white horse. It's not Jesus, because he has a bow but no arrows. He has a crown, but it's a Stephanos, which is a perishable crown. The crown Jesus wears is a diadema, which is the crown of authority. So it's a whole different person. It tells us that he sees the Antichrist come into power, but it will be the Antichrist who will seem to have all the answers for a world that's in confusion, and he will bring in a false peace plan with the nation of Israel. And when he signs his peace treaty, according to Daniel chapter 9, verses 24 to 27, he signs his peace treaty with Israel to allow them to rebuild the temple on the Temple Mount in Jerusalem. That is the start of the seven-year Great Tribulation period. That's when the clock starts for the 70th week of Daniel. He will seem to have everything under control. He's going to implement a one-world government. He's going to implement a one-world religion, and the Antichrist ultimately will be the one who will demand worship from everybody in the world that's alive on planet Earth at that time. But then God lowers the boom. He brings down the hammer. Verse 3, for when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them as labor pains upon a pregnant woman, and they shall not escape. Again, this is what Revelation 6 through 19 is all about. With all the Christians removed at the rapture, those left behind will falsely believe that they can create a utopia on planet Earth without God. They're going to create a utopia, a paradise, a place of peace. This is what they've been striving for. This is what the United Nations, that's their goal, but it's all without God. It's man doing these things, and they think they're going to do it with the Antichrist, but in that seven-year period, God's judgments will come in rapid succession. Every time a seal is open, another judgment comes forth from the Lord. After the first seal is open, the Antichrist is revealed, and then their thoughts of utopia and peace will quickly perish, vanish, because when the next four seals are open, there's going to be brutal, destruction and death, wars, famines like crazy. And it talks about wars breaking out all over the world, famines, pestilences, widespread death. Just the fourth seal, when that is open, it says 1/4 of the world's population dies. Just with that one judgment. Cosmic disturbances, as you go through Revelation 6, asteroids are going to be pelting the earth. Massive earthquakes like the world has never seen. Mountains will be leveled. Islands, it says, will be removed. It's going to be heavy-duty destruction. That's only the first six judgments of God. In fact, the people are so freaked out during this time of God's wrath. This is what they say, Revelation 6, in verse 16 and 17. And it said, they said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath has come, and who is able to stand?" And so they know this is God's wrath and judgment during this time frame. And when the Lord opens the seventh seal, that doesn't bring an end to the judgments. That just brings on the next set of judgments, the seven trumpet judgments. And those judgments devastate the world's vegetation, the oceans. Every time you read one of those judgments, it says a third of the trees burned up, a third of all the green grass is burned up, a third of all the oceans and the animals in the oceans die. You know, a third. God's putting the squeeze on the world at that time. If things aren't bad enough, when the fifth and sixth trumpet judgment sound, God allows these demonic critters to be let loose from the bottomless pit. And then these four angels, it says, that have been locked away in the river Euphrates are let loose. And just with the sixth trumpet judgment, those four angels, they're demons, they kill one-third of the world's population. So just with the fourth seal judgment, the sixth trumpet judgment, that's half the world's population destroyed. This is why Jesus said, unless these days were cut short, no flesh would be saved. But when the seventh trumpet sounds, God brings the seven bowl judgments. And those are worse than anything we can imagine, because it's not just a third of all the oceans and the creatures in the oceans. It says every living creature in the sea will die. Every tree will be burned up. California thinks it's bad right now. We're getting haze from their fires. Every tree, every green grass, it says, is going to be burned up. This is brutal. So the world's on the brink of total annihilation. That's why Paul says at the end of verse 3, they shall not escape. And unless those days were shortened, no flesh would survive. Notice Paul goes back and forth in this section. He says they and them, speaking of the unsaved world, and he says we and us. He's talking about believers. And he'll go back and forth. So this is how you need to know who he's talking about. They shall not escape, he says. But because we belong to Jesus, we will escape the great tribulation. I love when people say, well, you believe in a pre-tribulation rapture? You're an escapist. You believe in escape. I was like, yeah, you can be a stayism or whatever you want to call it. I'm out of here. You know, I'm going to escape. This is what Jesus said. Luke chapter 21, verse 36, he says, "Watch therefore and pray always that you may be counted worthy to escape all these things that will come to pass," talking about all the judgments that are happening, "and to stand before the Son of Man." The only way you and I are counted worthy to escape any of these judgments from the hand of God is to be found safe and secure in Jesus Christ. In other words, when a person receives Christ as their Lord, as their Savior, they put their faith alone in Christ alone for their salvation, we're instantly saved. We're instantly set free. We belong to the Lord. We've been bought by the blood of the Lord. And so we will escape these things. We're not part of this, and we'll see more of that in a moment. Look at verse 4. So he's talking about they and them, and then he talks about you. Verse 4, "But you, brethren, are not in darkness, so that this day should overtake you as a thief. You are all sons of light and sons of the day. We are not of the night, nor of darkness." Again, it's only because we are in Christ and Jesus lives in us that we are sons and daughters of light and day. We're not of the night, he says, nor of darkness. Again, because Jesus has washed all of our sins away. And because we are children of the light, we know what is happening in the world around us. We know that mankind is just going to make things worse and worse in these last days. It should not be a surprise when everybody's thinking we need to get back to normal. We don't know. We're not getting back to whatever normal was. The new normal is not going to be good. In fact, we only, not only know what is going to happen in the future, we know how everything came into being in the past. Most of the time, when the word light is used in the scriptures, it's referring to truth. We're children of light. That means you're children of truth. Children of darkness, that means they're under a lie. This is what we read in 1 John 1. Notice how light and truth are synonymous. 1 John 1, verses 5 to 7. This is the message which we have heard from him and declare to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. Spiritually speaking, you and I, as followers of Jesus, it doesn't matter how simple-minded you might be, spiritually speaking, we are so much smarter than the greatest scientists in this world who are atheists, because they're going around saying, believe science, you came from a monkey. I'm not real smart, but I don't think I came from a monkey. I believe what the Bible says. God created us after his own image and likeness. They believe there's no afterlife, that you just turn to dust, or, you know, food for the worms. We, on the other hand, are in the light, so we know the simple truth. Genesis 1, verse 1, if you believe this, the rest of the Bible falls into place. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The word created, bara in the Hebrew, B-A-R-A, means to create something out of nothing. He created everything in this universe out of nothing. He spoke it into existence. Only God can do that. And he'll do it again, and we get to watch him do it again when he creates a new heaven and a new earth. It's the same word, bara. We know why Jesus came from heaven to earth 2,000 years ago. He came to seek and to save that which is lost. We know where we're going when we die. We're going to go into the loving arms of our Lord and Savior. We know these things because God has revealed these things to us. Again, the world doesn't know these things. No matter how many PhDs and BS degrees and whatever else they got in front of their name or behind their name, it doesn't matter. It doesn't line up with the Word of God. They don't believe it. So as children of light, don't buy into the empty lies of the world. The world's ways are dark. Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus is the light of the world. We talked about this Sunday. He's the way, the truth, and the life. And he came that we might have life, and that more abundantly. Verse 6, notice again, he says, therefore let us, believers, not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. For those in the world, those who sleep, sleep at night. And those in the world who get drunk are drunk at night. Now here Paul uses the word sleep. We saw this last time when he talked about those who sleep in Christ will be raised first. And we saw the word for sleep there means to be dead. It just means you're at rest, you're at peace. But to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. When you die, you take your last breath here on earth, you take your first breath in his presence. There is no soul sleep. I went into that in detail last week. So it's peace with the Lord, not pain. It's rest, not turmoil. But here he uses a different word for sleep that means to be spiritually unaware or spiritually oblivious. You're not spiritually asleep. You're not spiritually oblivious. You're not asleep at the wheel, so to speak. Now, how does a person drop into spiritual drowsiness? By compromising the Word of God, by associating with the dark things of this world. And if you do, it doesn't take very long for you to start falling asleep spiritually. You get drowsy because you get lulled by the things of the world. So Paul is warning us not to be intoxicated with the things of this world, but be sober, sober-minded. The word sober means to have self-control. Self-control is part of the fruit of the Spirit. Check this out. You know this verse, Ephesians 5, verses 17 to 18. He says, therefore, do not be unwise. To be unwise is to walk in darkness. But understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not be drunk with wine or intoxicated with any other sinful thing, which is dissipation or wastefulness, but be filled with the Spirit. After all, when you are filled with the Holy Spirit, then you're walking in the light, even as He is in the light. And that's what God's wanting us to do. That's what Paul's exhorting us to do. That way we don't fulfill the lusts of the flesh when we're walking in the power of the Spirit. Then he says in verse 8, but let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet, the hope of salvation. So here he equates faith, hope, and love with spiritual armor. In other words, if our faith is in God and we have love for one another, our hope is in seeing Jesus in a moment in the twinkling of an eye. That's like having heavy-duty spiritual armor on, because you're not walking in fear. You know you're doing what God's called you to do. You're ready when the trumpet sounds to go and be with Him. And so you're not living in fear. You're not being intimidated by the enemy around you. You're like a good soldier who's on a lookout for the enemy's attack. We're watching out for our brothers and sisters as well. We don't want to see the enemy sneak up on them. We don't want to see them wounded with his fiery darts. And as good soldiers, we're wearing the armor of God, and we're watching for Jesus. We're ready to meet him when the trumpet sounds. Now look at verse 9. This is a key verse for what we're looking at tonight. He says, for God did not appoint who? Us. To wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, whether you're, you know, like Paul says, to live is Christ, to die is gain, we should live together with him. Therefore, comfort each other and edify one another, just as you also are doing. Now, I take great comfort in knowing that God has not appointed me to wrath. Again, his wrath during the great tribulation. I also take great comfort in this truth, but Paul's emphasis is not that we should comfort just for ourselves, but we want to comfort others, encourage others, remind others that you're not going to go through the great tribulation if you belong to Jesus. Because there's so many Christians, and I hear it all the time. Do you think we're going to face God's wrath and judgment? And they live in fear of that. Do you think we're going to see the Antichrist? I'm not looking for the Antichrist. I'm looking for Jesus Christ. I could give a rip about the Antichrist. Everything now is falling in place for him to be revealed. But for him to be revealed, 2 Thessalonians 2, 7 and 8, the restrainer, the Holy Spirit-filled church, has to be removed first. And then it says the lawless one will be revealed, whom Jesus will destroy. But I take great comfort to know that we are not destined for God's wrath. Paul makes this perfectly clear. God did not, notice, appoint us to wrath. Again, because we have obtained salvation in Jesus Christ our Lord. And notice as it says there in verse 10, who died for us. Why did Paul include that fact of the gospel, that he died for us? Remember, that's the first half of the gospel. Jesus died for us according to the scriptures, was buried, rose on the third day according to the scriptures. So the first half of the gospel is he died for us. Why does Paul include this? What does this have to do with being spared from God's wrath? Well, Jesus dying on the cross for our sins has everything to do with being spared from his wrath, from his judgment, from condemnation. Think of it like this. Sin will be judged by God. Unrepentant, unforgiven sinners will be judged by God. But Jesus died for our sins. He became the perfect sacrifice for our sins. Look at this verse. You've heard it many times. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 21. For he made him, Jesus, who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. In other words, listen up, it was on the cross that Jesus became the object of God's wrath. When he's hanging on the cross, that was when God poured out his wrath upon Jesus. And anyone who is in Christ, the wrath has already been taken care of, because Jesus took it in your place. He absorbed it when he hung on the cross. He took the penalty I deserve for my sins. He took all the punishment I deserve for being a sinner. He became the only acceptable payment for my sin. The payment was his blood. And so if you want to escape the wrath of God, both in the near future and forever, then you need to turn to the risen, living Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, because he alone is what the Bible calls the propitiation for our sins. That word propitiation, it means to satisfy God's wrath, or the satisfaction for God's wrath. Jesus is the one who satisfied the wrath of God on our behalf. If you reject his forgiveness, if you reject his sacrifice, then you will face God's righteous judgment. If you're around during the Great Tribulation, you'll face it then, but you will face it for all of eternity in the lake of fire, because that's also part of his wrath. But you don't have to face it. Jesus loves you. He died for your sins. 1 John chapter 2, verse 2 tells us, and he, speaking of Jesus, he himself is the propitiation for our sins. He satisfied God's wrath for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the whole world. That includes you and me, and you, your sins and my sins. But again, you have to trust Jesus. If you don't trust him, you're still under that cloud of judgment. The Bible often equates God's wrath to drinking from a cup. It's a brutal cup to drink from. It's a very bitter cup to drink from. It's called a cup of wrath. It's called a cup of indignation. It's called a cup of judgment. For example, in the book of Revelation, God sends an angel to warn the inhabitants on the earth not to take the mark of the beast. If you do, you will drink the full measure of God's wrath. This is what we read in Revelation chapter 14, verse 10. And he himself shall also, this is those who take the mark of the beast, they reject Jesus, he himself shall also drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out full strength into the cup of his indignation. He shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. Once again, Jesus drank from God's cup of judgment. And because he did, we who have received Christ, we have also have drunk from that cup. It's been paid in full. It's been taken care of. Remember, when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane, just before he was arrested, just before he was beaten and then nailed to the cross, he was in the garden and he was praying. And you know what he prayed three times? Here's what it says, Matthew 26, verse 39. It says, it went a little farther, fell on his face, and he prayed, "Oh, my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me." This is the cup of wrath that he knew he was going to be absorbing on the cross for our sins. "If it's possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will." And so onto the cross, Jesus went, and he willingly drank the cup of God's wrath for us. And it was on the cross that he cried out, remember, with a loud voice, my God, why have you forsaken me?" It was at that moment where the wrath of God was being poured out in full measure upon Jesus. He was taking the wrath that we deserve upon himself. You talk about grace, you talk about mercy, you talk about love, that's where it was demonstrated, as Jesus absorbed it all in himself. In fact, for every person who is saved by Christ, he offers us a completely different cup. It's a cup of fellowship, or a cup of communion. Because he drank the cup of wrath, now he can offer us the cup of fellowship. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 11, starting in verse 25, "In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes.'" That's why we are free. That's why we are not going to face the wrath of God during the 7-year Great Tribulation period. He bore all of our sins on the cross. He paid the price in full for our salvation. And so, instead of drinking the cup of his indignation in Revelation, we get the cup of fellowship, the cup of communion that he offers to us. Amazing. Look at these verses as we wrap up this little section here. John 3:36. He who believes in the Son has everlasting life. Do you believe in Jesus? Yes, I do. Then you have everlasting life. And he who does not believe the Son shall not see life, but, notice, the wrath of God abides on him. And so before somebody saved, before I got saved, I had God's wrath, this cloud of judgment hanging over me. But the moment he came into my life and I was born again, that cloud was forever removed. That's what he does for all of us. But if you don't come to the Son, if you don't believe him, that wrath hangs on you. Paul says this, Romans 5, verses 8 and 9. But God demonstrates his own love toward us. How do I know God loves us? Well, here's how he demonstrated it. In that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Much more then, having now been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. Praise the Lord. Remember we saw earlier in 1 Thessalonians in chapter 1, verse 9, it says, Paul is commending them. You turn to God from idols to serve the living and true God. 1 Thessalonians 1:10 then says, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come. This is awesome. This is what it's all about. 2 Peter 2:9. The Lord knows how to deliver the godly out of temptations and to reserve the unjust under the punishment for the day of judgment. So praise the Lord that we are not destined. We're not appointed to his wrath. It's all been taken care of at the cross, and it's only given to us when we gave our life to Christ. Praise the Lord. So look at verse 12. Let's go through this quickly. It says, and we urge you, brethren. Now he's going to give them some exhortations and encouragements in the rest of this chapter. We urge you, brethren, to recognize those who labor among you and are over you in the Lord and admonish you and to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake. Be at peace among yourselves. Here Paul describes the work of church leaders in three ways. First, he says, recognize those who labor among you. You know what? Titles are great, but that's not what's important. Leaders should be recognized by their servant's heart. We should be leading by example, not just saying, I'm a pastor, so you need to listen to me. No, we need to serve. We need to have a servant's heart. As some of you know, the word minister, it means an under rower in a slave ship or a merchant ship. It was the under rower. You were below deck, no light, no sun, and you're rowing. That's what a minister, that's where the word comes from. There's too many. No, they want to be the captain on top, shouting out, barking out orders. Do this, do that. That's not the way God wants us to serve and lead. Secondly, notice what he says here in these verses. Recognize those who are over you in the Lord. This is simply recognizing that genuine church leaders are under the authority of Jesus Christ. He's the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. And because we are under him, we need to be very careful how we lead and oversee God's church. This is what Peter says. This is the proper description of how to lead God's people. 1 Peter 5, verses 2 through 4. Shepherd the flock of God which is among you, serving as overseers, not by compulsion, but willingly, not for dishonest gain, but eagerly, nor as being lords over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that does not fade away. So that's a servant leader. You're not lording it over others. You're among the people. You're serving the people. The third thing Paul says, about recognizing, respecting genuine church leaders, that they admonish you. In other words, there's times, and this is what he's telling to the church there, you need to pay attention when the church leader gives you a warning. He gently reproves you. Paul says it like this, 1 Corinthians 4:14. I do not write these things to shame you, but as my beloved children, I warn you. And that should be our desire when we bring things up. You know, turn from sin, walk in the Spirit, don't fulfill the lusts of the flesh, repent of those things that are trying to ensnare you. These are for your admonition. Because we love you, we don't want to see you ripped off by the enemy. Look at verse 14. He says, now we exhort you, brethren, warn those who are unruly. Comfort the faint-hearted, uphold the weak, be patient with all. An unruly Christian is one who says, well, God's word may call this sin, but I think it's okay to do these things. No, you're being unruly. You're going against Scripture. You know, you might think, well, I'm not convicted by the Spirit. Well, that's because you've quenched and grieved the Holy Spirit. It's not okay with God. So we need to warn people, you know, this is hurting you. This is ruining your witness. This is causing other brothers and sisters to stumble because they're watching you. So please stop. Please repent. Then Paul exhorts us. He says, comfort the faint-hearted. This speaks of those who are naturally timid, who are shy, those who get easily discouraged. Notice he says we're not to come along the faint-hearted and rebuke them and condemn them. But he says, no, comfort them. That means to encourage. It means to reassure them. Many times a person is faint-hearted because they grew up being condemned or they were constantly rebuked, constantly criticized. So Paul says they need to be encouraged. They need to be comforted. Then he says here, uphold the weak. This simply means that when you see a spiritually weak brother or sister who's struggling with something in their life, come alongside of them. He says, hold them up. That's what it means. Lift them up. Don't kick them while they're down. Don't kick them while they're struggling. You know, hold them up. Uphold the weak. And at the end of verse 14, he says, be patient with all. That's probably one of the toughest ones. We look at this and like, oh, man. I'm tired. Remember Moses? 40 years in the wilderness with those idiots? All they did was grumble, complain. And he knew nobody, except for Joshua and Caleb, out of 2 million people, none of them are going into the promised land. They were over 20 years old. They're all going to perish out here. And he was mad. And he lost it one time. Struck the rock twice. God said, speak to the rock. And he struck it twice. I mean, if I was Moses, I'd be beating that thing until that staff just shattered, I'm sure. I mean, but he was just so, and that kept him out of the promised land. It's tough being patient. But patience is a fruit of the Holy Spirit. And it's the Holy Spirit who enables us to see people from God's perspective. That they are a new creation in Christ. That God's not done with them yet. That God's still molding them and shaping them. Paul says there in, Ephesians 2:10, we are his workmanship, or poem. That's the Greek word, poema. We're his workmanship in Christ, created in Christ Jesus for good works. And so he says, God's still working on them. So be patient. That's a tough one, but we need the Holy Spirit to do these things. Verse 15. This is another tough one, especially today. See that no one renders evil for evil to anyone. But always pursue what is good both for yourselves and for all. Again, as Christians, we need to be very careful how we represent Jesus to those who are not believers. Don't return evil with evil, he says, but return evil with good. God says, vengeance is mine, I will repay. Think of it like this. If an unbeliever says something mean and nasty towards you because you're a Christian, don't say something mean and nasty in return. Sometimes you just need to just take it. You're just like, okay, I'm sorry. Speak the truth in love. Pray that the Holy Spirit will bring conviction. Show them where, you know, they're in sin or whatever it might be. Jesus talks about that again on the Sermon on the Mount. We just saw it Sunday. Pray for those who persecute you. Verse 16, he rattles off a few exhortations here. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Now remember back in chapter 4, verse 3, he says, this is the will of God for you, your sanctification. Now you abstain from sexual immorality. We also saw how the will of God is found throughout the Word of God, and here's another great example here. He says, first of all, in verse 16, rejoice always. The word rejoice comes from the same Greek word for joy. Joy is a fruit of the Spirit. Joy is not something that we manufacture within ourselves, but it's something the Lord puts within our hearts. Christians, we should be the most joy-filled people in the world. But at the same time, don't make the mistake to try to substitute joy for happiness. A lot of Christians are trying to be happy. Don't worry, be happy. It's like, I can't be happy. Look at the world around me. Yeah, because happiness is based on our present circumstances. I'm happy. I found a $20 bill on the sidewalk. No, I'm sad because somebody just stole it from me. You know, I mean, your happiness goes up and down. Joy is a constant because joy is given by the Holy Spirit. It's the fruit of the Holy Spirit. It's not based on our circumstances, but it has everything to do with being in a relationship with Jesus. Having this joy, we can say, oh man, I rejoice in the Lord always. Why? Because I'm saved. I know where I'm going when I die. All my sins are washed away. I rejoice in what Christ is doing in me and through me. No matter what this world throws at me, no matter what Satan brings against me, I know I'm safe and secure in Jesus' hands. He said, nobody can snatch me out of the Father's hands. So we can have joy even in the midst of horrendous trials and struggles. So it's not the same as happiness. So rejoice always. Then he says, pray without ceasing. This doesn't mean that you are on your hands and knees 24 hours a day praying without ceasing. I had somebody tell me that once. You're disobeying the Lord. I was like, what do you mean? I'm out here witnessing to you. You're not praying without ceasing. It's like, what do you mean? He goes, you're not praying. You should be home praying. The Bible says pray without ceasing. He didn't understand. Pray without ceasing simply means to be in communication with God. You're praying throughout the day. You know, you're getting ready to meet somebody for coffee. Lord, I just pray you'll give me wisdom to speak the right words to this person. You know, your kids are driving you nuts, or maybe your grandkids are driving you nuts. And so you pray, Lord, give me wisdom how to deal with this situation. I don't want to be upset. I want to love them. And so we need to be praying and seeking the Lord. I mean, Jesus is not only our best friend, he is God the Son, and we should be in constant contact with him because we know he knows everything we're dealing with, everything we're going through, and we can find peace in him, strength in him. And so we pray without ceasing. We just call upon the Lord whenever we need to. People want to know, what's the proper position for prayer? Well, a lot of times people think, well, you got to fold your hands, close your eyes, bow your head, get on your knees. There's no proper position for prayer. The proper position for prayer is found in your heart. I mean, there's times you read the Bible. You know, David's raised his hands up. He's looking up into the heavens praying. Jesus looking up into heaven when he's praying to the Father. There's no proper position. Sometimes you'll see him falling on their face before the Lord. Again, it's a position of the heart. That's what's important. Then he says, here in verse 18 still, in everything give thanks. Give thanks for who God is. Give thanks for all that God has done. Give thanks for all that he's doing in your life today. Now, he does not say for all things give thanks, but he says in everything give thanks. There's a difference. You know, if I'm sick, I've been beaten down or whatever it might be. Oh, thank you, Lord, for this sickness. No, I don't do that. But in that sickness, I can say, thank you, Lord, that you are with me. You'll never leave me or forsake me. Thank you, Lord, that you're preparing a place for me in glory. Thank you, Lord, that this body is going to go away someday and I'm going to get a resurrection body. So not for everything, but in everything, we can give thanks. That's a proper perspective of Romans 8:28, where Paul says, and we know that all things work together for good to those that love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose. And the only reason we know that is because God is in control. He is sovereign. He is in charge of our lives. And so we thank the Lord in everything because in Jesus there is victory and there is triumph over all things. Verse 19, he says, do not quench the Spirit. And the picture Paul is painting of the Holy Spirit is that of a burning fire. And so he says, don't throw water on the fire. In our vernacular, we say, stop being such a wet blanket. I know Christians like that. They're always throwing a wet blanket on everything, trying to extinguish the fire, so to speak. In the context of this section, how do we quench this Holy Spirit? Well, if we're not encouraging those around us, we're quenching the Spirit. If we're not warning the unruly around us, we're quenching the Spirit. If we're not comforting, he said, the faint-hearted. If we're not upholding the weak. If we're not being patient with others, we're quenching the Holy Spirit. I mean, if we're always grumbling and complaining instead of rejoicing in the Lord, we're quenching the Spirit. Here's a biggie. When I wrote this down, you got to take heed to this. If we're talking to everybody around us about everybody else around us, you're quenching the Spirit. That's not good. But on the other hand, when we're submitting ourselves to the Lord and we're walking in the power of the Spirit and we're allowing the Holy Spirit to burn away the chaff in our lives and we're asking him to refill us overflowing with his living water, that's when the fire begins to, you know, roar once again, and you come alive once again, and you're able to speak the truth in love. You're not going to cower back, but you're going to stand up for what is right. And as a result, people will see less of us, and they see more of Jesus. That should always be our heart's desire, like John the Baptist. I must decrease, Jesus must increase. So don't quench the Spirit. Look at verse 20. Do not despise prophecies. So we need to recognize that the Lord speaks to his people. He speaks through his people. We need to have ears to hear what the Spirit is saying to us through his people. But at the same time, the New Testament gives us a lot of warnings about false prophets, false teachers who speak lies, who have covetous hearts, who try and draw people to themselves, who set dates for the return of Jesus, who simply try and mislead people away from the clear teachings of God's word. And so it's no wonder why there's so many people skeptical of when somebody says, oh, I have a word from the Lord. Here Paul says, do not despise prophecies. And I totally agree. We talked about this yesterday in our men's Bible study. We're going through 1 Corinthians 14. And there we see very clearly how this is to operate, because prophecy literally means to speak forth the truth of God's word. Primarily, it's forth-telling what God's word has revealed to us. In fact, here's the definition of prophecy in 1 Corinthians 14, verse 3. But he who prophesies speaks, this is how it needs to be interpreted, for edification, exhortation, and comfort to men. Under that definition, I love it when a person has a genuine word from the Lord. Unfortunately, there seems to be, you know, that seems to be the exception rather than the rule. So that's why Paul immediately follows up in verse 21, test all things, hold fast what is good. Again, if somebody ever says, I have a word from the Lord, don't despise what he has to say, but then test what he has to say. You don't just be gullible. You don't just say, oh, good, I want to hear it. Oh, wow, that's opposite of what my Bible says, but okay, I'll take it. No, we don't do that. 1 Corinthians 14:29 says, let two or three prophets speak, let the others judge. And the word there, judge, means to examine. It means to discern. So test what's being said, examine it, discern. Is this from the Lord or not? Now, how do we do that? Again, by simply testing what somebody says by the Word of God. This is the final standard. This is the authority we live by, the Word of God. Remember when Paul was running out of town here in Thessalonica, he goes to Berea, and then we're told in Acts 17, after he's explaining to them about Jesus from the Scriptures, Acts 17:11, it says, these were more fair-minded than those in Thessalonica in that they received the Word in all readiness and searched the Scriptures daily. Notice they're searching the Scriptures daily to find out whether these things were so. So again, search it out. Find out if what is being said. If you're watching, God forbid, TBN. If you're watching some of these televangelists, you better be testing what they say by the Word of God. That's an admonition right there from the Lord. Verse 22, abstain from every form of evil. Again, stay away from things that are false teachings. You know, it's been said, false teaching, you know, and false doctrine, it leads to wrong thinking, which leads to bad behavior. And so if you see anything that appears to be evil, get away from it, because more than likely it's a trap from the enemy. It's Satan trying to lure you in because, again, he wants to ruin your witness for Christ. Verse 23, now may the Lord of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so before Jesus comes for us, he wants our body, soul, and spirit to be sanctified, set apart for God's exclusive purposes. When Jesus paid the price to redeem us, which was his blood, and to save us, he bought us. And when he bought us, he bought the whole package. That means he bought your body, he bought your soul, he bought your spirit. He owns us completely. I see in this the trichotomy of man. In other words, our spirit, the Greek word there is pneuma, where you get like pneumatic tools, air tools. Spirit, that's what he's talking about here. Our spirit is what is dead to the Lord until Jesus came into our lives. This is why Jesus told Nicodemus, you must be born again. Because at that moment when Christ comes into our lives, he brings our dead spirit to life. Remember when Adam and Eve sinned in the garden? God told them, the day you sin, you shall surely die. They died that day, even though their body and soul lived for another hundreds of years. He was 900 and something years old when he died. But his spirit died that moment. That's what is in fellowship with the Lord, our spirit. That's where we are in communion with God spiritually. This is why Jesus tells the woman at the well, John 4:24, God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. Again, we can only know the one true living God and Savior when we are spiritually alive by the Holy Spirit. He brings us to spiritual life. Ephesians 2:1, you were dead in your trespasses and sins. And then Christ brought you to life spiritually. The soul that Jesus bought, he bought with his blood. The Greek word for soul, as you know, is psuche. That's where we get the English word for psychology. It speaks of your mind. It speaks of your emotions, your will. Some people try and say that the spirit and soul are the same thing. When the Bible talks about, it'll use in the generic sense, the soul of man. That refers to the whole package of man. But the Bible also distinguishes between spirit, soul, and body. In fact, look at this verse. It's so important. We just brush over this. But Hebrews 4:12 says, for the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul, psuche, and spirit, pneuma. So there's a division there that the word of God can split between of joints and marrow and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. This is why secular psychology can only do so much for somebody. They can't deal with the spirit. Secular psychology cannot deal with your spirit because they don't even know anything about the Holy Spirit or the spirit within us. Real eternal changes start within a person's spirit. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Now look at 1 Corinthians 6, starting in verse 19. This tells us that the entire package of our lives belongs to the Lord. Or do you not know that your body, the Greek word there is soma, S-O-M-A, that's your physical body, is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own, for you were bought at a price. What was the price? The blood of Jesus. Therefore, glorify God in your body. That goes against the Gnostic teaching. Oh, this body of flesh, it just doesn't mean anything. And so there was the Gnostics that said, you can live any way you want in the flesh because the flesh is just sinful and wicked and it's just going to perish for eternity. So I can do whatever I want in my flesh and still believe in Jesus. Paul says, no, you were bought at a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. In other words, you belong to God. So he's sanctifying us completely. We belong to God 100%. And I am so glad that we do, because if any part of me still belonged to me, I'd find a way to mess it up. But it belongs to the Lord. So verse 24, he says, he who calls you is faithful, who also will do it. So in 23, he says, God himself sanctifies us completely, and then he who calls you is faithful. He's going to finish what he started. That's Philippians 1:6. Remember? Being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. Verse 25, brethren, pray for us. Again, we need to be praying for one another. Verse 26, greet all the brethren with a holy kiss. Unless you're Andrew Cuomo, don't do it. I would say in our culture, a holy handshake or hug would do. I charge you by the Lord Jesus, or by the Lord, that this epistle be read to all the holy brethren. So for all of us holy brethren in here, you're only holy because you're in Jesus. You're not self-righteous, but you're holy in Christ. So he says, I charge you to read this epistle. So praise the Lord, we just read this epistle. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen. Remember the very first verse, he says, grace and peace be with you in the name of God the Father and in Jesus Christ our Lord. And here he ends it with grace. And that's how it always is. You start with grace, you continue in grace, you finish in grace, because he who began that good work in you will complete it. Just cooperate with the Lord, and your life will go so much better. Doesn't mean it's going to be happy, joy, joy, but it's going to be so much better, because even in the storms of life, Jesus is in the boat with you, and he says you're going over to the other side. He never said you're going under, because we freak out like the disciples. Lord, don't you care? We're going to perish. The wind and the waves are crashing in among us, and he rebuked them. After you rebuke the wind and the waves, oh, ye of little faith, I told you, the word says, you're going over. I didn't say it was going to be, you know, glassy waters and a nice gentle breeze, but I'm going to be with you in the boat. I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I'm with you always to the end of this age.